Yeah.
Okay, everybody, so it's time to continue. I want to remind you to rate and comment on the presentations today. And so let's welcome our next speaker, Huzaifa.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, so thank you for coming to this presentation. I know the topic looks a little bit technical, so a lot of people, you know, get kind of intimidated by the amount of mathematics involved, and not everyone has a PhD in mathematics, and neither do I. But yeah, I'll try to keep it as interesting and as simple as possible. The presentation is on LogJam, so you know, if you have been in the first presentation which Josh took, one of the big names which he mentioned on the screen on the left-hand side, which he probably did not spell out, was LogJam. This is a vulnerability in Diffie-Hellman key exchange, and if you don't know what Diffie-Hellman key exchange is, in just a few slides, I'll try to explain to you in a way which can be as simple, you know, as possible. And there is a really interesting issue in Diffie-Hellman key exchange, and I tried to give a little twist to the presentation, and you know, mention why government agencies, you know, would basically allow these kind of issues. So my name is Huzaifa. I am a principal software engineer. I've been working with Red Hat for 10 years now. I'm a part of various upstream security teams. Last I counted was around 15. So I'm a part of Mozilla, WebKit, LibreOffice, Xorg, PHP, and a couple of ones which I don't seem to remember very well. I spoke about shell shock last year. It was very well received. I used to work with Josh before he moved on to the team which has more money now. So, and I kind of, you know, he mentioned some attributes which security engineers have. So, you know, I was trying to look at the back of my mind, and I figured out that, you know, I would fit into most of the things which he talked about. Including, you know, does not like to talk and stuff like that. He also mentioned we people are extremely intelligent. So, you know, I would like to, yeah. Before I talk anything, small disclaimer. Last time I got spoken about with management, and you know, they did not like certain words which I spoke during my presentation. So, a small disclaimer. Anything which I say in this presentation is strictly my opinion, and probably, you know, is not the opinion of my employer, right? So right, let's get started. Various government agencies out there, and you know, when we talk about government agencies, the first thing which comes in our mind is definitely the NSA or the GCHQ, or you know, they are probably other agencies out there as well, and. If you look at the Snowden files and you know a lot of other references, they are basically actively trying to crack cryptography online, right? And the Snowden files basically tell us that there are three things which they are trying to attack right now. The first thing is they are trying to attack the SSL/TLS protocol because a lot of traffic uses that. Which you know, so Tilmas talked about HTTPS and SMTPS and you know whatever protocols probably have an S at the end. They are wrapped around by using SSL/TLS. They are probably also interested in trying to break VPN. And when I say VPN, it's mostly IPsec. They're also trying to break into SSH, which is probably 26% of all traffic on the internet. And when you want to break crypto, there are basically two ways of trying to do that. One is you try to attack an implementation. And you know, we have seen the recent case of Juniper some time back in which there was a backdoor or something like that, right? So one method of doing that is to attack an implementation, and basically two ways of doing that also. You pay tons of money to the person who makes the hardware or who makes the software, and you persuade him to have a backdoor in his software or hardware. That's one way of doing it. The second way would probably be to try to find a flaw in the implementation and try to exploit the flaw. There is a big problem with this kind of approach, and the approach is that not everyone uses the same implementation, right? So I mean, if I'm using a particular hardware device, not everybody on the internet uses the same kind of hardware or software device. So whatever effort you spend in trying to crack the implementation, that's probably only going to affect small number of people on the internet. The second and the better way of doing it is to attack the actual algorithms which run these security protocols on the internet. They are generic across all crypto products which we have, right? So if it was possible to crack AES, right? So if it was possible to crack AES, then everybody uses AES, right? So the holy grail of backdooring all crypto on the internet probably would be to crack AES. And once you crack AES, then it's like 99% of the game is done. So most of the crypto protocols on the internet, they use a combination of symmetric and asymmetric. Symmetric crypto is hard to break. And there are two symmetric crypto algorithms which are mostly used. One is AES, which I just mentioned. And second is RC4. You don't need to break RC4 because it's already partly broken. And most of the cryptographers seem to think that symmetric crypto is very hard to break. So we are just going to believe them in this case. On the other end, asymmetric crypto probably is not that hard to break. And when we talk about asymmetric crypto, there are two algorithms which are widely used on the internet. There is a RSA and there's a DH, which is Diffie-Hellman, right? So we are just going to have a brief look at each one of them and see which one of them would be more difficult to break. So a very simple representation of RSA, there's Bob and Alice. This is basically public key encryption. So Alice basically wants to send a message to Bob and hopefully make sure that the government agencies in between Alice and Bob are not able to see what the message is. So the first step is to generate a public-private key pair. So Alice basically needs to think of two prime numbers, P and Q, and then there is a product of two prime numbers, which is N is equal to PQ, and then there are two more things which come into play, and I'm not going to go into details of how they are derived right now. So there's an E, which is the encryption exponent, and there's a D, which is a decryption exponent, right? So basically, when Alice wants to send a message to Bob, she basically creates a public key, encrypts the data with the public key. She creates a public and a private key pair, right? And the communication is on the other way. So Bob basically encrypts the data with Alice's public key, right? The data is sent across the internet, and because Alice has her own private key, she's able to decrypt it, right? So I'm just being a little bit fast because we don't have a lot of time. So what are the best known attacks on RSA? So the best known attack is factoring N into its component prime N and P, factoring N into its component prime P and Q, right? So in the last slide, we saw that N is equal to PQ, and that's the whole that's the whole story around which RSA basically works. So if you really want to attack RSA, then you need to figure out a way of trying to factor N into its component prime, and it seems that it's not very easy to do something like this. The best known algorithm which we have is called the number field sieve, right? And there is a brief description of how the algorithm works. And so how much time does it take to break, right? So this is really interesting. If I have a 512-bit RSA key, it's going to take one core year, which basically means that if you have a machine with one core, it's going to take you 1 year to break, to factorize N into P and Q, right? Which is quite silly right now, because if I have a laptop, my laptop has got like four cores or two cores or something like that. So probably if I run some software on my laptop for a couple of hours, then I would be able to break the 512-bit RSA key, which is pretty silly right now. 768-bit is supposed to take 1,000 core years. There is freely available software on the internet. If you buy an EC2 instance, it's going to take you $72 to break a 768-bit RSA key, right? So what you need to do is you need to hire EC2 for, say, 4 hours or 5 hours or something like that, and run freely downloadable software on the internet on the EC2 instance, and probably in a few hours you would be able to break a 768-bit key. As the component size increases, as you see, it becomes increasingly more difficult. 1024-bit RAC key is supposed to take 1 million core years. And there is no public proof that it has been done publicly. Probably government agencies have this kind of infrastructure, and they have a much better algorithm, and they would be able to break these kind of keys. The recommended size currently is at least 2048-bit, right? Yeah. Now comes Diffie-Hellman key exchange. Okay. Probably equally widely used on the internet as RSA, Diffie-Hellman key exchange is much more simpler to explain than RSA. We have again two parties who want to exchange data with each other. What they basically need to do is they basically need to think of two numbers. One number is a prime P, which is called the generator. It's called a prime. And there's one more number which you need to think of, which is called the generator, right? So you basically, Alice and Bob, they need to think of two numbers. One is a prime P, and one is a number G, right? So once you do that, what Alice basically does is she thinks of a private key A, right? And the public key is G raised to A mod P, and that is sent to Bob. And Bob does the same thing. Bob thinks of a private key B, and the public key is G raised to B mod P, and it is sent to Alice, right? I know it's a little bit complicated. Now, how hard or how easy is it to break Diffie-Hellman key exchange? It is much more, Diffie-Hellman key exchange is much more harder to break than factorization. Basically, the whole attack comes down to something which is known as DLP, or discrete log problem, in which we need to solve this equation y is equal to g raised to a mod p. And the best known attack is called finite number field sieve, right? And if you see the algorithm, it is shown on the screen. Yeah. How much time does it take to break Diffie-Hellman key exchange? Slightly more time than RSA. 512 Diffie-Hellman key exchange key, 512 DH key will take around 10 core years. 768-bit will take 35,000 core years. 1024, it should be 1024, will take around 45 million core years, right? And the recommended key size right now is 2048-bit keys. So why Diffie-Hellman key exchange? Right, if we have a good asymmetric encryption protocol on the internet, why do we need something else? So here enter something which is known as PFS, or perfect forward secrecy. What PFS basically means is, theoretically, government agencies could record traffic on the internet. So if you use RSA to encrypt the traffic on the internet, and if you use the same key for 2 years or 5 years or something like that, which is quite normal on the internet, then government agencies could basically record all the traffic which is passing on the internet by using that key. And they have now they have two or five years, right? So they have a lot of time to factorize your key. So theoretically, probably 1 year down the line or 2 years down the line, when they are able to factorize your N, they would be able to decrypt all the traffic which they have recorded, right? So what you basically need to do is you need to sit on the internet, you need to figure out when the cert is going to expire, you need to record all the traffic which is passing through the pipe. And once you are able to factorize N, you automatically are able to decrypt all the traffic which you have recorded, right? Which is not the case in Diffie-Hellman key exchange, because when Diffie-Hellman key exchange initially came out, they basically assumed that when Bob talks to Alice each time, then a new P and a new G would be automatically negotiated, right? So when I talk for the first time, I think of a P and G, then the connection goes down. Then when I talk for the second time, the new P, new G, right? And then when I talk for the third time, the new P and new G. So basically, even if I'm recording all the traffic on the internet, unless I know what previous private parameters are used, it's really difficult to decrypt the traffic, right? So a lot of people basically started to advocate Diffie-Hellman key exchange over RSA. A lot of cryptographers also said that, you know, if you really want privacy on the internet, then you should actually use Diffie-Hellman key exchange. I have a few quotes from some famous cryptographers, which, you know, which I did not get a time to put on the slides. But there is a problem over here. And the big problem over here is perfect forward secrecy basically says that for each connection, you need to use a new P and a new G. But that is not really the case. Right, for each connection, we don't normally use a new P. For many connections, we use the same prime P. Right? So if many connections are using the same prime P, then you can do a lot of pre-computation and you can break Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So probably I'm going to show you a slide in which I'll show you how you can do a lot of pre-computation. And by doing pre-computation, you can actually quite easily break Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So this is probably a gap between the cryptographers and the people who actually implemented the library. Because the cryptographers initially thought that, you know, if you really implement perfect forward secrecy, then, you know, you are, for each time you are going to generate a new P and a new G. But that's really not the case. Because you generate a P once, and, you know, you probably use that for 5 years or 10 years or something like that. So how do we use this to exploit connections on the internet? So enter something which is known as logjam. Where when we talk of logjam, we are basically not only talking about government agencies who have large computational resources, but we are basically talking about people like you and me who have our laptops which say 2 cores or, you know, 4 cores or something like that, and we can actually use this vulnerability to do an active man-in-the-middle attack. And, you know, we can figure out what data is being sent on the internet. So in the 1990s and, you know, the years before and after that, US had a very strange policy in which, you know, they did not allow crypto of higher strength to be exported. So for Diffie-Hellman, they capped it to 512 bits. So it basically means that, you know, you cannot export crypto whose strength is more than 512 bit for Diffie-Hellman. We of course don't know why that was done, but probably because, you know, it's more easier for US-based government agencies to break these kind of, you know, low strength crypto ciphers. Because of that, they basically invented something which is known as export grade ciphers. So export grade ciphers are basically weak algorithms which are used. So like, you know, 40-bit symmetric keys, or, you know, 512-bit RSA, or 512-bit Diffie-Hellman key exchange. During a SSL handshake, the server gets to select what kind of ciphers would we want to use, right? A lot of crypto libraries which were made, like, you know, think of OpenSSL or NSS or GNU TLS. Most of these crypto libraries have support for these export grade, low core quality, or, you know, low strength size ciphers as well. Post 2000, what happened was, I think US became a little bit more relaxed, and, you know, they removed these export restrictions, and, you know, you could basically export cryptographic algorithms which have more strength. However, something interesting happened. The US relaxed its restrictions. The browsers did not remove the support for these low quality export grade ciphers, right? Hence the sub, and that was basically done because, you know, the servers need to maintain a kind of backward compatibility with these browsers, right? So basically what happened was, in post 2000, though US allowed higher quality ciphers to be exported, these low-quality ciphers did not get removed from the code which runs on our browsers, and, you know, it runs on our servers. So in the past 2 years, there have been two attacks which exploit something like this. So, you know, if you have heard of Freak, Freak is an attack on RSA. And, you know, when Josh mentioned that, you know, these named attacks have gone down, I basically disagree. Because, you know, we just saw an attack called Slot. I'm not sure how many have heard of that. SLOTH. which is kind of, you know, on how TLS uses MD5 to protect some signatures during handshake or something like that. So yeah, it's definitely not going down, and Josh doesn't look very happy with that. Yeah. So Freak basically uses 512-bit factorization. It's an attack on RSA, and it's an attack in which you can a man-in-the-middle attacker can actually downgrade the RSA connection to 512-bit. It's an implementation flaw, right? And the one which we are going to look at right now is actually a protocol flaw. So this is really more protocol flaw is really more serious than an implementation flaw. This attack basically uses a fast 512-bit Diffie-Hellman discrete log algorithm to downgrade modern browsers to use 512-bit Diffie-Hellman key. So I have a very good representation here, which I hope you guys would be able to, you know. So basically, this is Alice, and she's trying to connect to her e-commerce, you know, online bank website, and she's trying to, you know, make some transaction. So the first four or the five arrows which you see is the handshake. The first handshake is called client hello, and when client hello basically happens, the client sends a list of cipher suits which it supports, and the server gets to select one of them. What basically happens in a logjam attack is it's a man-in-the-middle attack. So there's a man-in-the-middle attacker between Alice and the website which she's trying to connect. And what the man-in-the-middle attacker basically does is when Alice sends a client hello, the man-in-the-middle attacker will try to remove all the cipher suits which Alice basically supports and add only one cipher suit to it, which is called DHKE export. Right, so only add support for the export cipher suit. And when that goes to the server, and we know that the servers are configured in such a way that, you know, the export cipher suits will also be on. The server will select the export cipher suit. And yeah, I know it's a bit boring, but you know, I can figure out because Josh is yawning. So, yeah, so let me try to make this a little bit more interesting. So yeah, there's a man-in-the-middle attacker, right? You try to contact your bank website, there's a man-in-the-middle attacker. What the attacker basically does is, the attacker downgrades your connection in such a way that, you know, the server will only be able to choose the export-grade weak ciphers, which we discussed some time back. And now the catch with SSL is that the handshake has to come complete, right? So the last packet which needs to go between the client and the server to complete the handshake is called finished, right? It's called client finished and server finished. And the handshake is made in such a way that the finished packet needs to contain a combination of all the packets which were previously sent. And the finished packet needs to be signed, right? And it is impossible for a man-in-the-middle attacker to sign it unless and until he has the private key. So here comes a very, very interesting part, right? So when I said earlier that, you know, a perfect forward secrecy only works if a new prime is generated each time, right? So that is not really the case, because a lot of implementations, including Apache, Mod SSL, and, you know, a lot of other web servers out there, they basically hard code primes, right? So what these implementations basically do is, they think of a good prime number. So, you know, let's think of a good 1024-bit prime number. Let us hard code it in our implementation of Apache, right? So each time when you use mod SSL plus Apache to do a DHKE, a Diffie-Hellman key exchange, you are going to use the same prime, right? And there are various reasons why it is done. It is very difficult to generate primes. It is very difficult to generate safe primes, right? And the bigger the safe, the bigger the prime, the more difficult it is. So, you know, if you want to generate a 2048-bit safe prime, it's going to take a lot of time, right? So if you go to your favorite website, facebook.com or gmail.com, and if it's going to take them 2 minutes just to generate the prime, you are not going to use the website, right? So the real interesting part is a lot of these implementations, they generate primes, they hard code primes, and I have a slide which shows you how bad it is. 97% of all HTTPS servers on the internet use three primes, right? There are three prime numbers which were generated, and they are used by 97% of all HTTPS sites on the internet. Top 10 primes account for 99% of all HTTPS sites, right? So theoretically, if I'm able to break 10 primes, I'm able to decrypt 99% of all HTTPS traffic on the internet. And if you want to look at these primes, so 80% of the primes use Apache 2.2, and it has got a 512-bit prime, which was hard-coded in the year 2005. Right? If you are using mod SSL, 13% of all hosts who use mod SSL, they use a 512-bit prime, which was coded in the year 1999. And if you are the proud Java developer, then 4% of all Java websites which use Java on the internet, they are using a 512-bit prime, which was, it was coded back in 2003. So basically, if websites on the internet which use prime, and if you are using a 512-bit prime, then most probably this prime has already been broken, right? Because it is now very, very easy to break these small prime numbers. So how does one attack this kind of implementation? So if you go to my previous slide, and if you see the algorithm which is used to attack, so if you see the algorithm over here, right, this algorithm can be basically broken into two parts. There's a first part in which you give P as the input, right, and you do step number one, step two, step three, step four, and at step number five, you will need Y and G, right? So what you can basically do is, if I know what P is, right, so I do know what P is, right, because we just saw that a lot of implementations, they basically hard code P. So if I know what P is, I can compute 1, 2, 3, 4, which is like, say, 90% of the algorithm, right? So it's very easy to attack. I look at Apache code, I find out what prime is used by Apache, I use this method to do pre-computation, I create a pre-computation table. And when a message is sent on the internet, my work till this point, till Y and G is required, my work till this point is already done, right? So what I just need to know is, I need to know what Y is, which I can see from the packets on the internet. I'll feed Y to the algorithm, and it's going to take me 70 seconds to crack, right? So I do a lot of pre-computation. Probably, my pre-computation will take a few years. Or, if I have a lot of cash, I'll buy a supercomputer. Or, I'll try to hire a lot of cloud machines or something like that. And for a few years, do pre-computation. And once my pre-computation is done, it takes only 70 seconds for each connection to be broken, right? So I'll see what Y I have, and it'll take only 70 seconds. I hope that makes sense. Yeah, so next slide. Yeah, so this is some work done by some researchers on the internet. So if I want to break a 512-bit Diffie-Hellman key, my first step is going to take 3 hours, the second one is going to take 15 hours, the third one is going to take 120 hours. So if I combine all of them, this is going to result in my pre-computation. And the last step, which involves actually sniffing packets on the wire, trying to find out what Y is, and to find out what the private key is just going to take 70 seconds, right? So after 1 week of pre-computation, I have a lot of data, and I need only 70 seconds to break packets under wire. So a log jam and our pre-computation can be used to break 80% of top 1 million HTTPS websites on the internet, right? What are the mitigations which I have? Most of the browsers which we know, they have raised their limit from 768 or 512 to 1024 bits. TLS 1.3 is supposed to have anti-downgrade flag in the client random handshake. So These are the two mitigations which we could use. There is a second attack scenario as well. And this basically says that if you have a larger Diffie-Hellman key exchange key, so you know, even if I have a 1024 bit key, it is quite possible that, you know, government agencies may be able to break the key. So to just give you a simple example, doing pre-computation on a hard-coded 1024 bit prime is going to take me 45 million code years, right? But this is the kind of research which, you know, which researchers do, right? But there are a lot of optimizations. And we need not run these algorithms on generic computers. We can run these algorithms on specially designed FPGAs or, you know, special chips. And once you do that, it is possible to speed up by around 80 times. So if I want to break 1024 bit, and I have 10 minutes, okay. So if I want to break 1024 bit key, it's going to cost me around 100 million USD. There are reports which says that government agencies are actually doing it. And why they want to do something like that? Because if I'm able to pre-compute 1024 bit prime, I would be able to decrypt 66% of IPsec VPN traffic on the internet, right? So if I spend 100 million USD and if I pre-compute 1024 bit key, I'll be able to decrypt 66% of all VPN traffic on the internet. I would be able to decrypt 26% of all SSH traffic, right? So there is a lot of motivation for the government agencies to spend a lot of money to do pre-computation and to be able to decrypt the traffic. Pre-computation for the second most known prime will result in decryption of 18% of all HTTPS traffic on the internet, right? So, yeah. What is the mitigation for this? Mitigation is probably, if it is possible, move to ECC. If ECC is not an option, then, you know, increase the bit size. Probably using 1024 bit is not safe. Increase to 2048. If bigger primes are not an option, then, you know, see if it is possible to generate a fresh prime each time, which is really difficult to do right now. And yeah, this is probably the end of my presentation. I would like to acknowledge there was a presentation given during 32C3, and, you know, I've tried to steal a lot of graphics from that presentation. And if you have any questions, I think we have some time. I would like to apologize. It was a little bit technically difficult, but yeah, I tried to. Yes. Theoretically speaking, we could do something like that. Yeah. So the question is, would it be possible to regenerate the primes in each release of mod SSL? Right. That's the question. So theoretically, we could do something like that. But, you know, the question is, I'm not sure how to answer the question. But yeah, I mean, that is definitely something which we could do. But, you know, my suggestion at this point would be to move to a stronger, would be to move to a bigger key size, or, you know, if possible, to move to ECC. Yeah. Yeah. Updated each series. Yep. Yeah. Yes.
Are you in trust if you do anything wrong? Do you trust them? I don't know. Oh, why?
Yeah, so that's
the kind of stuff they might have to do that. But that would be the question. Have you trust someone
to do with
your prime?
Sorry, what?
You are. So an additional question. So how difficult is it to generate? Why doesn't everybody generate it? Every time Apache starts, why don't we generate it?
Because it takes time to generate a prime number. Once a prime number is generated, there are a few specifications which the prime number needs to fall onto. If you have heard of, there was a SOCAT security advisory some time back, and it seems SOCAT was using a 1024 bit prime number, which was not even prime. Right, and they have been doing that for a long time now, right? So, you know, it just gives you a simple example of, you know, how difficult it is to generate a prime number and how difficult it is to actually check if it's a safe prime number. Yeah. Okay. So, Josh is basically saying that there is a YouTube video. Okay, it's called number file, and it basically contains some information onto, you know, how do you check if it's a safe prime number, right? Yeah.
Yeah. One question about the generating fresh primes. If only one end of the connection generates, say, fresh prime frequently, does it help, or does it have to be both sides?
There's only one side generating.
There's only one side.
The server is the one that sends the prime.
Okay.
Sure. Yep. Yeah, and if you try so if you try to generate a 2048 bit prime with that, it's going to take a lot of time. Yeah. Yep.
No, it's not just a prime. You can generate a prime fairly quickly. It's generating a prime who's
safe.
Safe
prime.
A large prime subfactor, which takes a much longer time. Try generating a Diffie-Hellman prime versus a DSA prime. DSA uses a much smaller number, which is still safe, but it's hard to check. And it's much, much faster.
Very special kind of prime, and generating those takes for 2048 bit, basically like that's like 15 minutes on a new Haswell 4 core, 4 gigahertz. So this basically like once a week that's the maximum you could do for a bit.
Yeah.
But that would be
what is the difference between a safe prime and a regular prime?
No, I think Rob.
In a safe prime, if you take the prime, subtract 1 and divide it by 2, it's another prime number. It doesn't actually have to be a safe prime to be secure in DHA. The same primes that you use in DSA would work. But in DSA, the way you generate that prime is you create a smaller prime that's still big enough to be safe, and then you publish that smaller prime, and then people can look and see, that is actually a factor of P. Therefore, I know P is safe to use for Diffie-Hellman.
Any more questions?
No. None of the protocols for Diffie-Hellman include an ability to send the subprime. So the only way to do this is to create a fully safe prime. So and then those are more expensive to generate. Yeah.
So if I can understand correctly, some software bundles like 3 primes, which are usable, would it help to generate like few 100,000 primes and give it to them, you know, to bundle it there?
how much time is it going to take to generate, you know, 100 primes or 1,000 primes or something like that? Plus, you know, So I think primes have a property which, you know, the bigger the prime, the more rare the prime becomes. So probably Rob knows about that. Rob? So he's basically asking, you know, is it possible to generate 100 or 1,000 primes? So I basically told him that, you know, primes have a property that, you know, the bigger the number, the more rare the primes become.
Yes, the bigger the number, the rarer they.
So it's extremely difficult to generate.
Yes, I'm asking if we have them generated, would that help in this with this problem?
So basically, it seems I'm out of time. Thanks a lot. When I say protocol flaw, I basically mean the TLS protocol, because the TLS protocol does not specify that a new P and new G has to be generated. It specifies that you use a P and you use a G. That is one thing. Second thing is, we probably talk after this, because logjam, there are two parts to logjam. There is a protocol flaw.
So these primes are actually hard coded into the software.